Okay, and now we're starting our second session of the day with word remainders. I am sorry for not pronouncing that correctly. Word is, we're very happy that we have somebody from Europe that we've flown in all the way on Zoom. And he's an associate professor at the Department of Operations at the University of Groningen. He's very well known in the stochastic mixed integer programming community, and he's worked on this for a very long time. He's published in journals like OR, Mathematical Programming, SIAM Journal of Optimization, eJourz, Informs Journal of Computing, and he's won several awards for his research, such as the, I'm gonna not pronounce this right either, the Guy's de Lev Prize, 2015 to 2017. So you'll have to correct me on that, for the best PhD thesis on the mathematics of OR in the Netherlands. And his work has also been supported by the Netherlands Organization for Scientific Research, and we're very happy to have him here today. So please, Ward, take it away.
So thank you for the introduction. So I'll be talking about a Bender's decomposition for two-stage mixed integer recourse models. So this is joint work with my PhD student, Niels van der Laan. Okay, yeah. And here you can see an outline of my talk. So first I'll very briefly introduce these two-stage mixed integer recourse models and what are the main challenges of those models. Then I'll explain our Bender's decomposition algorithm, and in particular the so-called dominating skilled optimality cuts that we are using in there. And then finally, I'll say something about the theoretical convergence, and I have some numerical results as well. And so two-stage mixed integer recourse models are a class of problems dealing with decision-making under uncertainty. So we have to make some decisions X here and now before we know some random parameters omega. And after we know these random parameters, we can make some decisions Y in the second stage, knowing the first stage decisions and these random parameters. And so the objective, at least in the first stage, is to determine these here and now decisions X. Given some deterministic linear cost, some deterministic constraints, and some expected future cost. And so these are the expected costs associated with the second stage, and we don't know these costs yet because we don't know what these random parameters omega will be. And so this expected value function Q is going to be an expectation over omega, and so an expectation of the cost in the second stage. And V omega x represents the second stage cost. And so it's a minimization over the second stage decisions, linear objective, and also linear constraints that may contain the first stage decisions as well. And here I assume that all the parameters, plus the cost and the recourse matrix, they can all depend on omega, so they can be random, but they are only random when we make our first stage decisions x. And once we make the decisions Y, and we know what these parameters are. And so I'm focusing on mixed integer recourse models, meaning that in both time stages, my decisions can contain integer restrictions. And I'm also making some standard assumptions. So I'm assuming that there are only finitely many scenarios, omega s, have a probability ps each. And so in terms of notation, I'm going to write phi omega s x as phi s of x. So I'm going to use only the scenario for that. And what happens, of course, if you have finitely many scenarios, and then that this expectation becomes just a summation. Because if there are finally many scenarios, it's just a weighted sum with the probabilities of these second stage cost functions. And I also make some several standard assumptions, like that the recourse is sufficiently expensive and relatively complete, meaning that the second stage costs are finite for every first stage decision and in every scenario. I assume that the first stage feasible region is bounded, and that all model parameters are rational. Okay, so if we focus on solving these models. And in particular, if you look at the first stage, and then you'll see that the difficulty is in Q of X, is expected value function. And because otherwise this would be just a deterministic mixed integer program. And so in particular, if the second stage decision variables contain integer restrictions, so if some of them are integer, then this expected value function Q is typically not convex. And so then we're dealing with a non-convex optimization problem. And so here are some examples. This is the expected value function for a simple integer recourse model. And so it's a one-dimensional function, but you can see it's piecewise constant, discontinuous, definitely not convex. This is a two-dimensional example. Again, Q is piecewise constant. It has jumps at several places, non-convex. And this one also has many pieces. It's not even piecewise constant. But you can see this is really a mess, this function, discontinuous, not convex. So very, very challenging to solve. And so this is in strong contrast with the, let's say, continuous counterparts of these models. Because if the second stage decisions are all continuous, so if there are no integer restrictions, then we know that Q, this expected value function, is convex. And there are many decomposition algorithms out there that exploit convexity. And so the classical ones are the L-shaped algorithm, regularized decomposition, but there are much more algorithms that build upon these. And so also based on the success of these decomposition algorithms, there has been several decomposition algorithms for problems in which the second state variables do contain integers. And for example, integer L-shaped method, disjunctive decomposition. I've listed a few of them, but there are many more in literature. If we focus on these methods, however, and look more closely, and then we see, for example, for the first one, that this integer L-shaped method is really developed for the special case where all first stage decision variables are binary. And so if you go through this list, you'll see that this restriction actually holds in more of these papers. Here, restriction is it only applies to pure integer models, so where all decision variables are integer. And this one, based on ILP duality, has an intractable master problem. So it's more of a theoretical nature. And so this kind of explains our contribution. And so we also have a Bender's decomposition algorithm with integer decisions in the second stage, but we are dealing with a general mixed integer variables in both stages and also with randomness in all second stage parameters. Okay, and so I'll now try to explain how our Bender's decomposition looks like. And so it's for mixed integer recourse models. And so it means that we have to deal with this non-convex expected value function Q. And so this is the type of master problem that we get. And so the master problem approximates the first stage of our decision problem. And so here, these blue lines, they represent this simple integer recourse example that I showed before. So this is the expected value function Q. But instead, we're going to work with a outer approximation, this dashed line Q out. And so this outer approximation, we're going to assume it's convex polyhedral. And this is one of the properties of the algorithm. And so we want to maintain a convex polyhedral outer approximation so that the master problem remains tractable, so that we can still solve this master problem. But we want to iteratively improve this outer approximation and in the end hope to recover the convex envelope of Q, which is in some sense the best outer approximation or convex polyhedral outer approximation that you can get for this function. Okay, so how are we going to do that? And this also explains a little bit the difference with what's in the literature in these previous papers. We're actually going to create nonlinear lower bounds for the second stage subproblems. And so this is something that in other papers, what you see, they use linear lower bounds to keep a linear master problem, but we're going to allow nonlinear lower bounds for the second stage subproblems using our current outer approximation. Yeah, but this will create a nonlinear problem in the master. That's not what we want. We want to maintain a convex poiedral outer approximation. So we're going to transform these bounds into linear optimality cuts for the master problem. Okay, so here's the approach in more detail. And so here you see again the master problem corresponding to the first stage. It's connected to several subproblems. And so those are the second stage problems for each scenario. So here you have scenario one until scenario three. It has three scenarios in the example, but in general there can be up until capital S. And they are mixed integer programs because they may contain some integer decisions. And so in these pictures over here, you see the plots of these second stage value functions. And so they differ for each scenario, or they're slightly different. They're actually translated in this example because they correspond to this simple integer recourse value function if you take the average, or at least the correct weighted average. And so what are we going to do? Well, we're going to iteratively follow the following procedure. First, we're going to solve this master problem using only the outer approximation. And then we get some current solution x bar. And we send that solution and the current outer approximation to the scenario subproblems. And then for each scenario, we're going to create a lower bound for the cost function. And it's allowed to be a nonlinear one, but it has to be of this form. So we're creating a lower bound. The first part is just a linear part. And then this is going to be the nonlinear part, but it has to depend on the current outer approximation. And in fact, we're going to multiply it with tau. And so if this is large, it means its outer approximation becomes more steep. Then we multiply by minus one. So we flip it around, and that's how we use it to create lower bounds. If we have these lower bounds, then we send them back to the master problem to create a new cut. And so repeating, first we solve the master problem. And so we end up somewhere over here. We get a current solution. We send it to the scenario subproblems. Let me see, I can't see the screen exactly. Yeah. So then over here, so now we want to create a new lower bound. Yeah. So first for the first scenario, here is x bar, but we use this outer approximation so we can create a nonlinear lower bound. And we can also do that for the second scenario. X bar is at the same place, but the function is slightly translated. And so we get a slightly different lower bound, nonlinear. And here in the third scenario, it's on an even different place, and we get this lower bound. And so by selecting the correct coefficients, we can somehow transform all these functions in this way to get these lower bounds. Okay, final step. We send back all this information back to the master problem, and we take the weighted average of all these lower bounds, and then we may get this type of cut. And I will now try to zoom in on this cut that we have here. So one observation about this cut that we get is that this cut is going to be tight at x bar if it's tight at x bar for all subproblems. So here you can see it's tight over here. So if it's true for all subproblems, it will also be true over here. And you can also see the cut is nonlinear and non-convex. And this is actually not what we want, because now we get either nonlinearities or binary variables in the master problem to model this linear cut. So that's not really what we like. And you can see that easily if you look at the formula for this cut. So the Q is just the weighted average of the second stage cost functions. And we replace those with the lower bounds. And then we get a nonlinear cut, nonlinear lower bound for Q of X, and where alpha is actually the weighted sum of these alphas over here, beta is the weighted sum of the betas, and tau is the weighted sum of the taus. And so we do not want to use this cut, we want to do something different. So again, we're going to look at scaled optimality cuts. And I'll now try to explain how we get these. And so we take Q of X, we just rewrite it. So Q of X plus tau times Q of X divided by 1 plus tau. So this is just the same. But then we're going to use that the outer approximation is a lower bound for Q. So we get it over here. And in the next step, well, we're going to use that for this nonlinear cut. If I move tau times the outer approximation to the other side, I know that the sum of these is greater than alpha minus beta transpose X. So I can replace the numerator by alpha minus beta transpose X. And then this is my scaled optimality cut. And it may look something like this. And so if you look at properties of this cut, well, it's linear in X, because once you fix alpha, beta, and tau, this is just a linear function in X, or maybe affine. Then, and this is an interesting observation, if the outer approximation, so this dashed line, is equal to the nonlinear cut, so over here and there, then the outer approximation also has to be equal to the scaled cut. And that's also what you see happening over here. And so at these two points, the three of them intersect. And that's very easy to see. If you move this to the other side and divide by 1 plus tau on both sides, you get this expression over here. And so the final remark that I want to make, it's about the scaling factor, tau. And so this factor tau, with which you're multiplying this outer approximation and the nonlinear cut, it's actually affecting how good your scaled optimality cut is. Because if tau becomes larger, this becomes steeper down, and you're intersecting your outer approximation somewhat over here, and you get a worse outer approximation improvement. And so we want to use so-called dominating scaled cuts. And the key idea is related to what I just explained. And so these nonlinear tight cuts that we have over here, they do not necessarily give us the best scaled cuts. Because there's still this scaling factor tau, and if it's large, the scaled cut is not that good. And so there is a real trade-off between how tight this nonlinear cut is and the scaling factor that we use. And so our idea is to use dominating scaled cuts. And so we try to find cut coefficients that somehow maximize the value of the scaled cut where it ends up at X bar at the current solution. And so for example, if we would have used a nonlinear cut like this and then scale it, we actually get a better scaled optimality cut. And we can maybe even do still better here in this example. And so in formal notation, what happens? Well, this set pi of S, depending on the outer approximation, is the set of feasible cut coefficients that gives us a lower bound for the second stage problem over here. And so the set of coefficients giving us a lower bound. And well, we are going to optimize over these cut coefficients where the scaled cut at X bar ends up. So you may wonder, how good are these dominating skill cuts? Well, for that we have the so-called, what we use, skilled cut closure. And this is a theoretical concept because we don't want to really compute this in an algorithm. But we investigated what happens if you take the maximum over all possible skilled cuts that you can make using this current outer approximation. And so given the outer approximation, and this skilled cut closure is just the function that you get if you look at all possible skilled cuts and take the maximum. And so as an example, we only not only look at this one, but maybe we can also make this skilled cut and maybe more. And that gives us the skilled cut closure. And so then I get to the main theorem of or the main convergence theorem that we're about to, that we could derive. And that's if we iteratively apply this skilled cut closure. So we start with the outer approximation. We call that phi zero. And if we define the sequence phi k, where we iteratively take the skilled cut closure, then this sequence of functions actually converges uniformly to the convex envelope of Q. And so in the end, they converge to the best convex polyhedral outer approximation that we can get. Of course, you may have wondered already, how are we actually going to compute these dominating skilled cuts? And because if you look at this problem over here, there are several challenges. The first of them is that it's a joint optimization over all scenario subproblems. And because these alpha, beta, and tau, they're the averages of these alpha s, beta s, and tau s. And also there's this nonlinear objective function over here, this quotient, that we have to deal with. And so what do? Instead, we work with a auxiliary model where we introduce a penalty parameter, rho. And rho, it puts a penalty on the scaling factor. And so this denominator over here, we add a penalty parameter rho, and meaning that we dislike the solution if tau is too big. And the clear advantage of doing that is that this problem becomes separable over all scenario subproblems. And so this is just a weighted sum over the alpha s and beta s and tau s. So this really is separable per scenario. And so we can solve these subproblems in parallel. And of course, the objective function is linear. And so that's a big plus. Yeah, but what I actually like the most is that if it turns out that C of rho is zero, then this auxiliary model, and then it must be the case that rho is equal to rho star, the optimal objective value over here. And the optimal solution in this problem, in this auxiliary model, actually is also optimal in that model, and this gives us our dominating skilled cut. Well, to see that, if zero is zero, then for all feasible alpha, beta, and tau over here, you can see that their objective should be smaller than zero, because zero is the maximum. And if you rewrite that, so this to the other side divided by 1 plus tau, you can see that the objective over here must be smaller or equal than rho. But because the maximum is equal to zero, there is also a optimal value for the cut coefficients. And there, this holds with equality, so this holds with equality as well. And so we really need to find rho for which C rho equals zero. And so what do we need? We need a root finding algorithm, or for example, bisection or Newton method, for solving C rho is zero. And this is possible because rho is just a one-dimensional variable. And so we really can do bisection. And actually you're using a kind of Newton method, or I call it a Newton method, even though this is not function is not everywhere differentiable, but this gives you an idea of how we find this value for rho. And then the second thing we need to do is solve this scenario subproblem. And it's given here and only depends on the cut coefficients per scenario. And so it's what I call the the final piece of the puzzle. So how do we do this? Well, this part is just a linear part. And so the difficulties are hidden in the set of feasible cut coefficients. And so what we do actually is here, this is the second stage cost function. And so it's a minimization over y. So we replace this by q transpose y. And we make sure that this constraint holds for all feasible y. And so we move the y over here. It needs to be feasible for all y. And we also replace this outer approximation with a theta and make sure theta is larger than the outer approximation. And then this constraints need to hold for all theta. And this is now linear and it has to hold for all x theta y in some C of S in some set. And so summarizing, and I'm speeding up a little bit, this is C as rho. And if you look closely, it's essentially a static robust optimization problem, but with a non-standard uncertainty set CS. Because in terms of the coefficients, this is just linear. And these are some constraints that hold for all values in some uncertainty set, but it's non-standard because X and Y are actually can be integers. And so if you would have the convex hull of C of S, then it will be a standard static robust optimization problem. But of course, we do not have that. And if we need to make it, it can be hard. And so actually, this problem is quite related to what Merv has been talking about. But we have two solution approaches for dealing with this. One is row generation. It is kind of the cutting plane algorithm for previous method where we iteratively determine extreme points. And we also have a cutting plane method where we try to get a partial representation of this convex hull using cutting planes. So given the time, I'm going to skip the numerical results. So what's maybe interesting to mention is that in terms of future research, I've also done some work on convex approximations of two-stage mixed integer recourse. And I'm really looking into whether we can apply these scaled optimality cuts also to cases where we are not working with a outer approximation that is a pure lower bound, but where it may be just an approximation and not always a lower bound of the expected cost function, this expected value function Q. And we're trying to see what happens if we are applying these cuts, these skilled optimality cuts to these convex approximations, and to see if we can further improve these convex approximations and when we have a good starting point. So a version of the paper is in Optimization Online. So if you're interested, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to take them.
Thank you very much, Ward, for that super clear talk. And I think that in the interest of time, we will keep the questions to the breakout room, if you don't mind, but which we'll go to right away. And then please also for everyone, join us for the next dots. It'll be once a month from now on until at least April. And the schedule is up on the website. And yeah. Forward it to anybody who's interested in your students or your department or other people in your company and so on. So hoping to see you at the next time. But if you're interested, please stick around. We will have breakout rooms right now for each of the speakers. And also you can just stick around and chat amongst yourselves as well.